Hello everyone. Thank you for joining us today for the webinar on supply of goods and services under VAT. I'm your host Ashika, and this webinar is powered by Zoho Books, cloud-based VAT-compliant accounting software. This is our second in the series of webinars about VAT, and today we are going to talk about the impact of VAT on the supply of goods and services. I assume that most of you are familiar with VAT. For those who are still not very clear about it, VAT is an indirect tax that is levied on the value of goods and services. We call it an indirect tax as it's paid by end consumers to the sellers of the goods and services, who then collect the tax and pay to the government. Now, this session is divided into three main parts where we'll discuss supply, the types of supply, and the components of supply. Now, what do we refer to when we use the term supply? Supply refers to all the goods and services that are exchanged for consideration. We say that a supply has taken place when there is a transaction between two people, out of which at least one is a registered taxpayer. Now, this includes buying goods to sell them, outsourcing a service, and importing and exporting goods. Purchasing, selling, and stock transfers are considered supplies even if there is no exchange of money. Next, we move on to the types of supply under VAT. So now they are broadly classified into three categories. Under taxable, we have zero rated and standard rated, and then we have exempted supply. We also have three other categories: out of scope supply, deemed supply, and composite supply. Zero VAT rate will apply to certain goods and services in the UAE. This includes exports made outside GCC, supply of international passenger transport, supplies made to certain means of transportation like aircrafts and ships, investment in certain precious metals like gold, and the first supply made to residential buildings. Now, this supply could be rent, lease, or sale of the buildings, and certain healthcare and educational services. VAT will not be imposed in some cases, such as certain financial services, the supply provided to residential buildings, which is the second supply onwards, local transportation of passengers, sale of bare land, and life insurance. Also, the supply of residential property is exempted only if the lease duration is more than 6 months or if the tenant holds an Emirates ID. Now, this brings us to a very important point to be noted. Businesses who are engaged in supply of goods and services under the category of zero VAT rate must register under the VAT system. So if they do this, they can claim from the government the VAT they had paid on their purchases. On the other hand, businesses supplying exempted goods and services will not be able to reclaim the VAT incurred on their purchases. Standard supply. The goods and services that are not included in zero-rated and exempted sector will be grouped under the standard tax rate of 5%. The VAT treatment of real estate depends on whether it's a commercial or residential property. Like as we saw earlier, while discussing zero-rated and exempted supply, residential property is mentioned under both categories. Only the first supply provided to residential buildings is categorized under zero-rated, and this is done so that the owner can claim VAT that was incurred on the purchases involved in construction. From the second supply onwards, the supply provided to residential buildings will be exempted, and the supplies related to commercial properties, which include sales or leases, will be taxable at the standard VAT rate of 5%. Out-of-scope supply. When an overseas supplier or a non-registered person supplies goods or services to a person situated overseas, then it's considered an out-of-scope supply. Now, there are two main types of out-of-scope supply. When a VAT-registered business owner from the UAE supplies goods or services to a VAT-registered business owner located in another GCC state, then this supply is considered out-of-scope. And the other one is merchant trading. Now, we use this term to describe any transaction where goods are imported from an overseas supplier and sold to an overseas buyer. So if you notice, in this transaction, the goods are not brought into the UAE at all. Let's see an example to understand it better. Now, there are two businesses, A and B. A is in Hong Kong and B is in London, and they specialize in food products. Now, say A sells food products to B. So the food products are directly shipped from A's factory in Hong Kong to B's branch in London. And these goods do not pass through the UAE at all, though the distributor is located in UAE. So now, the sale of these food products is considered an out-of-scope supply. deemed supply. We'll begin with an example in this case. Let's take the example of Ahmed, a supplier. So in a typical scenario, Ahmed would buy some goods, sell them to a customer, and the customer will pay him for the goods. Later on, Ahmed can recover the VAT incurred on purchases, and he'll account for the output VAT, which is borne by the customer towards the end of the transaction. But in the case of deemed supply, it varies a little. Ahmed would buy the goods, he'll recover the input tax that was paid on the purchase, and he'll give the goods to his customer for free. So now the customer has the goods, but nobody has paid VAT, which was due on the supply. So on the whole, goods and services that are brought for business purposes, but later used for private use or used as gifts or samples are called deemed supplies. So let's dive deep into deemed supplies as it's very crucial for most business owners. There are three main types of deemed supplies: personal use of business resources, goods held at the time of deregistration, and goods imported into the UAE and then transferred to another GCC state. Personal use of business resources. Items that are sometimes used for both business and non-business purposes are categorized under this section. We can take the example of printers here. Say, for example, Maria owns a digital print shop. So now she has a printer which she'll use for both business purposes and personal purposes. Now, how should she handle VAT in this case? She has two options. Option number one, she can either distribute the input VAT between her personal and business usage and later recover the VAT that was used for business purposes. Option number two, she can claim total input VAT and make an output VAT adjustment wherever the printer has been used for personal use. Goods held at the time of deregistration. Output VAT is charged on the replacement cost of the goods, and this is based on the duration and the condition of the goods. In case you're wondering what deregistration is, a VAT registered person in the UAE can apply to deregister if they no longer make taxable supply or if the value of their taxable supply is lesser than the threshold value for 12 consecutive months. Goods that are imported into the UAE and then transferred to another GCC state. If a business owner imports goods and pays import VAT on them, assuming that the goods will remain in the UAE, but later on exports the goods to another GCC state, then the transfer of goods will come under deemed supply. So in this case, the importer will have to repay the import VAT and address the transfer of goods as deemed supply. However, there are certain exceptions to deemed supply, and any supply will not be categorized as deemed supply if any of the following conditions are satisfied. If no input tax is recovered for the goods and services, if the supply of goods or services falls under the exempt category, if the input tax recovered has already been adjusted for the supply under the capital asset scheme, if the value of supply in the past 12 months does not exceed the amount mentioned in the executive regulation of the decree law, if the goods are supplied as samples or monetary gifts, if the total output tax for all deemed supplies during a 12-month period is less than the amount mentioned in the executive regulation of the decree law. So the last and the final category is composite supply. When two or more goods or services are bundled together, it's called a composite supply. A composite supply includes a main component which is essential to maintain the purpose of the bundle. Now, can you think of an example instantly? You'd probably be familiar with this. Airline service. When you purchase an air ticket, it often includes the cost of in-flight refreshment. So here, the air ticket is the main supply, as it wouldn't make much sense to sell just the food without the ticket. So these are the three other categories. Now let's move on to the most important part of the webinar, components of supply. So there are three components of supply, and it's very important for you to know about them to claim your input VAT correctly and also to file your returns without any hassle. Place of supply. Place of supply is where a transaction is said to have occurred, and we determine place of supply for a transaction to differentiate between domestic, intra-GCC, and non-GCC business transactions. Place of supply is determined differently for goods and services. We'll first see how it's done for goods. For the supply of goods, the place of supply is the location of the goods when the supply takes place. And exceptional cases are when there's a cross-border supply, supply of water and energy, or real estate. In case of services, the place of supply is where the supplier is established. Again, exceptions include cross-border supply between businesses and electronic services. So this is just the basic outline. I hope you've gotten the idea of what place of supply is. Now let's view the place of supply for goods and services in detail. And quite a lot of viewers from our previous webinar had asked us for an elaborate explanation on this topic. Place of supply of goods. The categories under this section are domestic supplies, exports to non-GCC states, intra-GCC supplies, and imports. Domestic supply. When the delivery of goods is made within the UAE, then the place of supply is the UAE. For example, if a furniture dealer supplies goods from Abu Dhabi to a customer in Sharjah, then the place of supply is the UAE. Exports to non-GCC member states. If the goods are dispatched from the UAE to a non-GCC member state, the place of supply is the UAE. For example, a company in UAE supplies machinery to a customer in London and declares the finished goods as export in the UAE. So here the place of supply is the UAE. Intra-GCC supply. When goods are transported from the UAE to another GCC member state, we should take into consideration the registration state of the customer. Only then can we declare the place of supply. So there are two cases. The first one, if the customer is a VAT-registered taxable person, then the place of supply is the final destination of the goods. For example, if a supplier in the UAE sells goods to a VAT-registered customer in Saudi Arabia, the place of supply is Saudi Arabia. This also includes the customer to pay the VAT under reverse charge mechanism. In the second case, if the customer is not a VAT-registered taxable person, the place of supply depends on whether the supplier exceeds the VAT export threshold. So you can see two columns. The first one is below threshold. If a supplier falls under this category, it means that the total amount of exports made by the supplier is below the mandatory registration threshold in the destination member state. So in this case, the place of supply is the UAE, and UAE VAT should be paid on the exports. Above threshold or exceeding threshold. If a supplier falls under this category, it means that the total amount of exports they make is above the mandatory registration threshold in the destination member state. So this destination member state is the place where you've been sending your goods to. And in this case, the place of supply is the destination member state, and VAT should be paid in that state. Import. Import is of three main types. Import of goods into the UAE, import of goods into the UAE for export to another GCC state, and import of goods into the UAE and later transfer to another GCC state. Import of goods into the UAE. The place of supply for imported goods is the country where the goods are declared for consumption. Say, for example, a businessman in Abu Dhabi imports perfumes from the UK. The place of supply is Abu Dhabi, and the supplier should pay VAT under the reverse charge mechanism. Import of goods into the UAE for export to another GCC state. If the goods are imported into the UAE, by default, the place of supply is the UAE. But if the importer expects to transfer the goods to another GCC state, then special conditions will apply. So there are two conditions. The importer should pay import VAT without using the reverse charge mechanism, and they cannot recover the VAT. And the import VAT can only be recovered in the GCC state where the goods are transferred. Goods imported into the UAE and then later transferred to another GCC state. If a business owner imports goods and pays import VAT, which can be claimed later, under the expectation that the goods will stay in the UAE, but later on they export the goods to another GCC state, then the transfer will be treated as a deemed supply, which is subject to VAT. And the importer will have to repay the import VAT. Now we move on to place of supply of services. The place of supply of services is determined based on the place of residence of the taxable supplier. Now this is the basic rule, and the basic rule always applies unless it's overridden by a special rule. So these are the exceptions to the basic rule. Installation services. The place of supply for installation services is where the installation is done. Imports from outside GCC. If the supplier is a non-UAE resident who provides service to a VAT-registered resident in the UAE, then the place of supply is the UAE. Say, for example, if a VAT-registered UAE resident receives accounting services from an accountant in India, then the place of supply is the UAE. hotel and restaurant services. As for hotel and restaurant services, the place of supply is where the services are performed. Real estate related services. Now, this includes all the services rendered by real estate experts and agents and services related to construction work. The place of supply for real estate related services is the location of the real estate property. As for telecommunication and electronically supplied services, the place of supply is where the services are received or used. And finally, the place of supply for passenger transportation services is the location where the transportation begins. Next in line is the value of supply. Value of supply is simply the amount collected by a supplier for the supply of goods or services. And this includes all the expenses and charges like shipping and handling charges. Now, we have a very simple formula for easier understanding. Consideration, which is monetary or non-monetary payment made by the buyer, minus VAT will give you the value of supply. So there are two cases, and let's consider the example of Khalid, a supplier. Now, he has supplied goods to a customer for which consideration is paid by the customer. Now, if the total consideration is monetary, that is, the customer chooses to pay Khalid back in any form of currency, it could be cash or digital money, then the value of supply provided by Khalid will be the market value without the tax, and it will include all the expenses and shipping and handling charges. However, if the total consideration or a part of the consideration paid by the customer is not monetary, say for example, the customer could have supplied some goods or perhaps outsourced a service to Khalid, then the value of supply provided will be calculated based on the monetary portion plus the fair market value of the non-monetary portion, that is the goods or services that the customer had provided, excluding the VAT. And a very important point to be noted here is that if the value of supply is expressed in foreign currency, then it should be converted to dirhams or the currency of the relevant member state based upon the current exchange rate. One last component of supply is the date of supply. It's also called the time of supply. The date of supply for a transaction is the date on which taxes are levied on the goods or services that are supplied. And business owners should know when output VAT is levied on goods and services. Date of supply for goods. When goods are transported, the date of supply is the very date the goods are removed to be dispatched to the destination. If the goods are not transported, then the date of supply is when the goods are made available for the customer's use. Say, for example, a supplier delivers goods in installments that have to be assembled. So in this case, the date of supply is the date when the goods are assembled or installed. Also, business owners often have queries regarding the date of supply while filing returns for a quarter. So we can solve this by taking a very simple example. Let's consider the first quarter, that is January to March. So if you're sending out a delivery note in March and the goods are out for delivery in April, then while filing returns, this transaction will be considered as a part of the first quarter itself, though you're sending out the delivery note in March. Date of supply for services. The date of supply for services is the date on which the services are performed or completed. And generally, tax is levied on the earliest of these three following dates. The date of supply of items, the date on which the VAT invoice is issued, the date of receiving full or partial payment for the items. If the goods or services are supplied continuously, then the tax will be levied on the earliest of these three dates. The date of payment listed in the invoice, the date of actual payment, or at least once in the period of 12 consecutive months. So with that, we've come to the end of this webinar. And business owners should note that all the businesses in UAE, irrespective of whether they are registered or not, should retain financial records like balance sheet, profit and loss statement, and records pertaining to fixed assets, payroll, inventory, and stock levels. And they should also retain accounting records of payments, receipts, purchases, sales, revenue, and expenses. And these records should be maintained for a period of 5 years at the least. So this means you should make sure your firm has an efficient accounting software, even if you're not registered under VAT. We hope you enjoyed this webinar and found it productive. We will have more webinars in this series, and you can find more resources under the VAT resources on the Zoho Books website. We also have upcoming live events on December 12 and 13 to get you VAT ready. You can follow us on Facebook and Twitter for more updates on VAT. And in case of any queries, Feel free to contact us at support@zohobooks.com. Thank you.